So today's class, till now we have discussed about the scope of sociology, synthetic school and formalistic school. So today we'll continue in that. We are going to study what is the subject matter of sociology, which is part of your syllabus. And the subject matter of sociology can be a continuation to the scope of sociology. Okay, so subject matter of sociology, it actually tells you what the sociology subject consists of. That's why we can say it is related to the scope of sociology. The relationship between sociology and the other sciences are that all of them study the society. For example, politics, you know, it is the people subject are the people, and the politicians rule over the people in the society. Similarly, anthropology is a study of the society. And economics also is about the people's income and expenditure, okay, and the general as a country as a whole, the income and expenditure. So in that view, if you see, sociology is a study purely of the society and the people who are part of the society. So we can say that sociology and other sciences are related in this way, okay. And for example, we come to the next aspect. If we analyze one example in the society, if we say that a family is there and there is disorganization in the family, what is disorganization? There is problem in the family. What are the causes of the problems in the family? Who will tell differently? For example, if the family has financial problem because of the husband or wife losing their job, then it becomes an economic problem in the family. Okay, because of the finances, there is problem in the family. Similarly, if there is health problem in the family, then it is a medical problem, it's a biological problem, and because of that, there is problem in the family. So each subject will define the problem related to that subject. But sociology is a superficial subject which will study all these aspects. It will study the economics, it will study the health problems, and all this together, and the family as a whole is taken and studied. That is why sociology encompasses all these subjects, or it contains all these subjects. We'll see how different sociologists differentiated or subdivided sociology. One question possible in this could be, what are the subdivisions of sociology? We will first see what Durkheim told about the subdivisions of sociology. He told that sociology can be divided into social morphology, social physiology, and general sociology. Okay, these are the three things: social morphology, social physiology, and general sociology. Morphology actually means the components. Okay, what in the society, what are the components? The people are the components. So studying about the people and the population is called a social morphology. We will study the population size, the density of the population, and the distribution of the population. So the number of people who are living in the society, and the size of the population, and where they are living, which area, whether they are living in a mountainous area, whether they are living in the city, whether they are living in the village, all their distribution. This study of the population is called as social morphology. This is according to Durkheim. The next division of sociology according to Durkheim is a social physiology. You already know, in anatomy and physiology, you study in anatomy, you study the structure of the body. In physiology, you study the function of the body. Same way, Durkheim says in social physiology, you study about the functions of the society. For example, what are the functions of the society? The functions are economic function, religious function, moral function, and these are all the other components of the society, and a study of these is called as social physiology. Finally, general sociology is about the philosophy or the thought process. So philosophical part of society is called as general sociology. These were the three divisions as per Durkheim. Then there was another sociologist called Karl Mannheim. Okay, Karl Mannheim, and he divided sociology into two main sections: systemic and general sociology, and the second one is historical sociology. Systemic sociology he describes as people living together, the factors of living together, as it is called as systematic sociology. And historical sociology is how we compare the previous generations with the present generations, or the primitive generations with the present generations. For example, how the ancient human beings lived, and that is a study of historical sociology, and comparing it with the present day society, it's called as historical sociology. It can further be divided into comparative sociology and social dynamics. Okay, comparative sociology, as the name says, is comparison of the primitive people and the present people. And social dynamics means movement. So social dynamics means what is the interrelationship between the various factors in the society and the institutions in the society. For example, there are religious institutions, there are caste institutions. So what are the relationships between these institutions in the present day and in the past? This is social dynamics. This subdivision of sociology is according to Karl Mannheim. Then we'll come to the subdivisions of sociology as per Ginsberg. Okay, Ginsberg says that there are four branches of sociology. They are social morphology, social control, social process, and social pathology. Social control and social process you will study in detail in the second chapter, but anyway, I'll give an introduction. Social morphology we already studied as per Durkheim. He also told social morphology is a division of sociology. So just like he said, Ginsberg also says social morphology deals with the quantity and quality of population. So the quantity, it includes the number of people in an area. Quality means the density of the population, how they are live. So all this aspects related to population of a place is called as social morphology. Social control, you know, control means authority. So who are the authorities in the society? The people who are in the police force, people who are in the ministers or the government. So all these people who are in authority, sometimes religious people also have authority over the people. So all these controlling people, study of these controlling people is called as social control. Then social process means how things happen. So cooperation between people, when you cooperate with each other, when there is conflict with each other, when there is a fight with between each other. So here there is a process going on between one group and another group, or two societies or two countries. For example, if India and Pakistan, if there is cooperation, if there is trade, or if there is war, all these are called as social processes. And finally, the fourth subdivision of sociology as per Ginsberg is social pathology. Pathology is always problem. In the humans also we have pathology. Pathology means those parts which are not functioning properly is called as study of parts which are not functioning properly is called as pathology. Same way in the society there are problems that we face. There could be problems like poverty, because people are poor, unemployment, joblessness, and then crime. All these are problems in the society. There can even be riots, fighting in the society, all these which we hear in the news every day. These problems, the study of these problems is called as social pathology, and these are the four subdivisions of sociology as per Ginsberg. And Sorokin also had some divisions of sociology. He said it is the study of general characteristic common to all classes of people. And as per him, sociology can be divided into social system, cultural system, personalities, and their structural aspects. So you can see that the scope of sociology is very wide, and the subdivisions of sociology also, each sociologist has a way of subdividing society. So these are the subject matters of sociology, and it can also be said that this is the scope of sociology also. Okay, then before we finish this topic, I'll just tell you about the significance of sociology or importance of sociology. Okay, so sociology can be a study. Okay, what we are doing is theoretical study, but it should also have practical implications, how we apply it in the society. That is very important. If you don't have any application for a subject, then there is no use in studying the subject. For example, why do you study max? One of the applications is, if you go to a shop, if you buy things, you should know how much money you gave, how much money you get in return. So the calculations that you study in mathematics. Similarly, what do you study in sociology? How can you apply it in the society? Okay, that is very important. So the first thing that a sociologist studies and the importance is the awareness of cultural differences. You know, within Vellore, how many cultures are there? You know, people in VIT who are working and studying in VIT, they have a different culture. People working and studying in CMC, they have a different culture. People working and studying in Adukambare Government Hospital, they have a different culture. So, you know, within a city, there are people with different cultures. This is one aspect. Then there is the actual culture based on religious differences, based on caste differences, based on difference in the state. For example, within India, a person in Karnataka will have a different culture. Person in Tamil Nadu will have different culture. Person in Kerala will have different culture. We have different festivals. For example, Tamil people, we celebrate Pongal. Kerala people, they celebrate Onam. It is all very similar, but there is difference. This cultural differences and the awareness and the study of it is one of the most important implications or significance of sociology. Okay, and based on this, we can face problems also. For example, unless a person has a particular way of living in the society, then there will be problems because of that, and problems can be solved with government policies. So based on your culture, the government will make policies. For example, in Kerala, they make policies which are related to their own state. One example which I will tell you, which may be a little funny, you know, during the coronavirus lockdown in Kerala, the government has told that the wine shops should be opened for people who have medical problems. If they don't drink, then they will come into have problems. So that is a cultural thing. So based on the culture of Kerala, the government has opened the wine shops there. Whereas in Tamil Nadu, the government has strictly told all wine shops will be closed, because the Tamil Nadu culture is a different way of culture. So this is one example. The other example is in US, for example, people in this lockdown, even because of coronavirus, they are not able to stay inside the house. They are traveling here and there. Whereas in India, we are able to control the coronavirus because people are staying inside their house mostly. One or two may be coming out. But generally, this is a cultural difference, because Americans think that freedom is very important, whereas Indians think health and family is very important. This is a cultural difference. So these are the differences in culture, and government also makes policies based on this cultural differences, and that is one of the important significance of sociology. The second importance or significance of sociology is the effect of policies. Okay, I already told government makes policies based on our culture, and the effectiveness of these policies can be assessed by sociologists. For example, how do you assess the effectiveness of a policy? In India, for example, I told the government has made lockdown strict and all the people are following. So how do we assess? We assess by checking, comparing the number of people affected by coronavirus in India and assessing the number of people affected by coronavirus in US. There may be other factors also, but the policy of the government has a direct role in the number of people affected. In US, you see there are 75 lakhs of people already affected, whereas in India, it is a few thousands. Why is the policy of lockdown effective in India? Because of people staying at home. And who will study all these effectiveness of the policy is the sociologist. So the assessment of the effectiveness of policies is a importance of sociology. Finally, the third important aspect is self-enlightenment. Okay, self-enlightenment. Enlightenment means, you know, Buddha got enlightenment under the Bodhi tree. So when you study sociology, you will be able to understand the society, you will be able to understand the people, you will be able to understand the problems of the society, and that will give you additional knowledge. So that is self-enlightenment, which you will get through the study of sociology. Okay, now we'll go to the various careers and specialization in sociology. okay, sociology is a career. You are all medical sociology students and you have taken it up as a career. You are going to work in this field. So what are the disciplines in which you can work? For example, in today's situation, a sociologist can be a consultant, he or she can be a teacher, a policy maker, researcher, administrator, clinical counselor, social critic, interviewer, journalist, probation officer, career counselor, social worker, recreation worker, program evaluator, planner, marketing person, administration person, coordinator, and personal manager. These are some of the broad areas. Okay, and your knowledge of sociology can be used in fields such as teaching, social research, social work, in industries, rural planning, urban planning, public administration like the civil services or IAS, policy making, politics, architecture, child welfare, health welfare, study of old people and computer industry, military intelligence, international relations, criminal justice. Okay, so social workers are needed in criminal justice. Why does a person do a crime? If you go to the juvenile home where children with who have troubled past are there, you can find out why they are doing crime. So that is a stat, that is one opportunity for sociologists. Same way in international relations, I already told how people in different cultures behave. So a sociologist will assess how an American behaves and how India can have relationship with those people. Or you can work in child welfare. Child welfare, we have a Hope House which is very close to Karigiri, and the Hope House, they find destitute children. They see children who are in the railway station, who have run away from their home, and they bring them here and they counsel them. So you find out why the children run away from home. And so there are different areas in which a sociologist or a social worker can work. And medical sociologists especially, you work mainly in the hospital, but you can have relationships with the other areas of work also. Okay, and then there's a list of specializations within sociology. In sociology, what are the specializations that you can do? You can study about social gerontology or aging. Why people become old and what are the problems they face in the old age. Then human ecology, industrial sociology, biosociology, then social movements, rural sociology, comparative sociology, marriage, family, public opinion, criminal justice, cultural sociology, demography, and military sociology, sociology of mental health, sociology of work, urban sociology, sociology of knowledge, sociology of art. These are all different areas in which you can work. This, as time goes, you will understand what a sociologist does in different areas. And so there are various areas in which a sociologist can work, but you all are medical sociologists, so you work in a specific area, and that area is the social aspects of health and illness. Okay, when you come to second year, you will understand there is a subject called biomedical model of health and the biomedical model of health and social model of health. Okay, biomedical model of health looks at the medical part, diagnosis and treatment of a disease, whereas medical sociologists, they study how a person becomes sick. Suppose a person becomes sick because of stress in the family. There is a problem between father and son, or husband and wife, or mother and daughter, mother and daughter-in-law. These are all problems that we commonly come across in the family, and this family can lead to social problems like suicide. It can lead to social problems like health issues, stress leading to heart attacks. So if a patient comes to you with heart attack, you will assess the social situation of the patient, because the health may not be related only to the medical part or the dysfunction of the body, but it can also be due to dysfunction of the society, of the family. So a medical sociologist will study these aspects of society and how it affects the health of the individual and the community as a whole. So this is the social model of health, which is the main function of the medical sociologist, studying this and applying this for better health, better medical free, medical problem free life. That is the sociological model of health, and medical sociologists play a major role in this area. Okay, so with that we conclude this aspect of our class. The next class we will see about the sociology of India and relationships between sociology and the other sciences. With that we'll conclude the first chapter in your syllabus. Thank you.